Welcome into episode 113 of The Checklist, brought to you by Secure Mac. I'm Ken Ray.
And I'm Augustrometer.
A bypass in Apple's hours-old update, scammy subscriptions and how to stop them, and GrayKey is getting stuck in the lock. Look, everybody, it's Big Daddy Trometer. And it's another edition of The Checklist, brought to you by Secure Mac. On Tuesday of this week, Apple released iOS 12.1. It was also on Tuesday of this week that a security researcher found a way to bypass the passcode on a locked iPhone and access the contacts list on that phone. That's a phone running iOS 12.1, which, did I mention, came out just hours before this flaw was found. From the site The Hacker News, Jose Rodriguez, a Spanish security researcher, contacted The Hacker News and confirmed that he discovered an iPhone passcode bypass bug in the latest version of its iOS mobile operating system. Now, generally speaking, I don't worry too much about these, and personally, I'm not worried about this one either. I'm not worried because I work from home and my phone goes with me where I do. Additionally, I don't usually worry about these kinds of stories because the steps to access the info usually involve a strange series of taps and settings and maybe the sacrifice of a small animal. I mean, they're usually tough things to pull off. This one is not. Here are the steps. You call the target iPhone from any other iPhone, and if you don't know the target phone number, you can ask Siri who I am, or ask Siri to make a call to your iPhone number digit by digit, or use Siri to call your own iPhone. As soon as the call connects, initiate the FaceTime video call from the same screen. Now go to the bottom right menu and select Add Person. Press the plus icon to access the complete contact list of the targeted iPhone. And by doing 3D touch, or one assumes haptic touch, on each contact, you can see more information. Now this works even on a locked iPhone, and I get why. It's super convenient. And it's apparently a totally easy thing to miss. I guess part of the reason I wanted to bring this story today was to say yes, even the seemingly infallible Apple is fallible. But also I wanted to re-examine the whole convenience versus security thing. Apple wants things like adding users to a call, especially FaceTime now that it supports multiple users. Apple wants to make things like that super easy to do. And of course, users want it to be easy as well. But in the move to convenience, Apple has left not a gaping hole through which just anyone can walk, but a little hole through which even a mildly determined ne'er-do-well can squeeze. Now, I know you and I have talked about this before, August, but for you as a developer, how do you personally figure that line between convenience and safety?
You know, it really is a tough trade-off when you start looking at those things. And you know, in this particular case, you're potentially letting somebody see your contact information, which isn't the worst thing in the world. It's not like it's your bank account unless you're storing your bank account number in your contacts, which would be a weird thing to do. But, you know, you are letting people see your contact information. If you've got a Rolodex that has Kanye's number in it, then maybe it's a problem. But if you've got a Rolodex with Kanye's number in it, you should probably be committed anyway.
well, sorry, okay, here's sorry. The thing. No, it's quite all right. Here's the thing, though. Like I know a couple of famous people that you know. I don't know them personally, but I know you know a couple of celebrities, and they wouldn't necessarily want their information out there.
Absolutely.
So if somebody knows that you know somebody famous, if they can distract you and go in, then they've got that person's number. I've got one or two numbers in my phone that maybe the whole world would want to know, but here's the thing. You just broke up with your girlfriend and I have your girlfriend's phone number and she changed her phone number because you're a horrible person, blah, blah, blah. I mean, there are any number of reasons that you might not want somebody to have access to your contacts. It's not just all of your contacts in aggregate. It is any one of those numbers could be something that somebody else shouldn't have access to.
No, totally agree. And, you know, I'm not saying that that information should be publicly available. But what I am saying is that this could be a lot worse than what it seems to be on the surface. You know, I think Apple probably at some point made a judgment call and said, you know, do we want to give people access to the contacts, or do we want to like block that so they have to, you know, log into their phone to be able to use it? And I think they erred on the side of convenience, and it's probably going to bite them a little bit because, you know, as this story goes wider, they're going to reexamine that. And I would imagine they would probably just reduce that down to just names instead of names and numbers and other contact information. That's probably the smartest way to do it.
That's a really interesting point. So you think they looked at it and said, it's fine, go ahead? Or do you think this is just like, because my assumption was that, you know, somebody was looking at it and going, wow, this will be a great convenience. And then it's out there. And then somebody else is like, hey, hang on a second. Maybe this isn't the best thing in the world. I mean, do you think they really, you know, weighed the pros and cons of that? Or did they just go, this is totally awesome? And then once it's out the door, they're like, oh, right.
I think I'm probably giving them way too much benefit of the doubt. Okay. You know, I would like to think that they think every one of these things through before it goes live. I know from a practical point of view and just from experience, that's not always the case. You know, developers, product managers, even CEOs have great ideas and they go, we have to do this. And they don't see the consequences coming. You know, I'd like to think that Apple did see the consequences and just said, it's not that big of a deal. But yeah, you know, who knows what really happened.
Yeah, the thing is, it's sort of a damned if you do, damned if you don't kind of thing. I mean, you say you want to give them the benefit of the doubt, and I feel like I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt as well. Yours is, yeah, I think they thought it all through and decided, and that's your version of benefit of the doubt, and mine is they can't have thought about this, otherwise they never would have. Anyway, if you're wondering what phones are affected, the answer appears to be all of them, or modern ones anyway. The Hacker News says the new passcode bypass method seems to work on all current iPhone models, including iPhone X and XS devices, running the latest version of the Apple mobile operating system, i.e. iOS 12.1. Since there's no workaround to temporarily fix the issue, says the Hacker News, users can just wait for Apple to issue a software update to address the new iPhone passcode bypass bug as soon as possible. Now, what's funny about that to me is, you know, we're taking our conveniences such for granted that we're not going for the obvious solution. The Hacker News says wait for a fix since there's no temporary workaround. But of course, I mean, there are workarounds.
Sure there are. You know, and if you're really freaked out about this, the easiest thing to do is just turn off access to that capability. You do that by going into settings, then Siri and search. You'll see some toggles that are probably on and you want to turn those off. Those include the toggles that say listen for Hey Siri, press home for Siri, and allow Siri when locked. And of course, as I say this, my phone just activated right next to me.
Okay. Yeah. So here's the thing. That's why, I mean, let's be clear. It's if you're freaked out about this. We're not saying everybody has to go in and turn all of these things off. It's just, it was weird to see the Hacker News go, well, there's nothing to do but hold out. And it's like, well, no, actually, you can also turn the whole thing off. To be clear, too, we're not saying, you know, and I don't think the Hacker News was saying that you shouldn't update iOS 12.1 because of this. I mean, even if this is something that concerns you personally, you can go in and turn those things off, as we said. In the meantime, Apple's security site says iOS 12.1 addresses over 20 security issues, you know, which for most of us would make the update worth grabbing.
Absolutely.
Well, I'm not sure this is really a security story, but it is something for which to watch. Cult of Mac ran a piece probably about a week ago as we record this, highlighting actually a TechCrunch piece that said that scammy subscriptions were plaguing the App Store. At issue were apps that offer free trials, then kick over to paid subscriptions in a super short period of time and sometimes at exorbitant rates. Examples included the Scanner app, an app for a document scanning service that flipped from free trial to paid in just 3 days. though that free-to-paid conversion was hidden in the fine print, according to the piece. The app QR Code Reader, which converted from free to paid in 3 days and got people to pay for a function that's actually built into the iOS camera app. And then there was the Weather Alarms app, which was something that the piece said used a sneaky interface to get users to subscribe for $20 a month. Now, these three apps were said by Cult of Mac to be taking in between $1 million and $14.3 million a year. There were, I think the middle one was like $5.6 million a year or something like that. So no small amount of money being made by these apps, even for the one that was only making $1 million. Now, there is good news. Noise from these stories, plus a story from Forbes, seems to have gotten Apple's attention. Within days of these scammy app stories, the QR Code Reader and Weather Alarms were gone from the App Store, as were 11 of the 17 apps mentioned in the Forbes article. Now, scammy apps are dodgy apps, but here's the thing. Even if you are tricked into a subscription, getting out is easy if you know how to do it. Mr. Trometer, will you enlighten us, please?
Oh, I'd be happy to. You know, the easiest thing to do is go to the iTunes store, either on your computer or your iOS device. On the iOS device, scroll to the bottom of the store page, tap on your Apple ID. On a computer, tap on Account on the right-hand side of iTunes. And then once you're in, look for the word Subscriptions. When you tap that, you can see what subscriptions you have. You can disable them if you want to. And I will point out that, you know, if you've been affected by one of these scammy apps, just email Apple. They tend to be pretty good about refunds for really bad things. They don't like you to know that, but they're actually really good about it.
Yeah. And here's the other thing, too. This actually works for subscriptions that you know you're getting into. Like, let's say there's a game or a service that you want to try out just to know more about it or to try it, but you know that you don't want to pay for it. In iTunes, you can actually start your free trial. Then you go immediately to your Apple ID and cancel the subscription. Just like, you know, all those steps that August just talked about, you do that, you'll get a notice saying that if you're in the free trial, you can keep using the app until the free trial expires. Additionally, Apple does email you when you start a subscription, letting you know that you've started a free trial, how long that free trial lasts, and when and how much you'll be charged should you continue past the free trial. And there's also a link in that email to review your subscriptions. Now, of course, you don't want to click on every email that comes in that says, hey, we're from Apple, click on this. But if you just started a subscription, I mean, like, to try it out, to make sure that I knew what I was talking about for this edition of the checklist, I actually started a trial to Texture, which is the magazine app that Apple bought. And within a minute of me downloading and signing in to Texture and saying, yes, I want to try the free trial, I got an email from Apple saying, hey, you downloaded Texture, you started a free trial, it's going to charge you this much at this point. And there's even a link down at the bottom that says, and if you want to review your subscriptions, click here and do that. I mean, you know, so there are things you have to know, like, you know, were you expecting an email from Apple? Is it a legit email? And there are lots of things. I know there is a past edition of the checklist that you can find that does talk, you know, about how to tell a scam email from a real email. But again, if you get that email and you're not sure if you actually started a subscription, follow those same steps that August mentioned a moment ago. Go into your iTunes account and see if a subscription was started. And if you like it, great. If you don't like it, go ahead and cancel. And, you know, lastly, if you're already in a paid subscription, canceling won't do anything about charges that have already incurred, or already been incurred, rather. But hitting cancel will ensure that you're not charged again. So, yeah, it's actually probably not a bad thing just to keep an eye on from time to time. But there are ways to get out of the situation if you end up in a bad one. A follow-up to a story we've followed for a while, the state of GrayKey in a moment, but first, a word about Mac Scan 3 from Secure Mac. You know that having a Mac is not all the malware protection you need. Having something else have your back is a good thing. You need to stay ahead of the bad guys, and Mac Scan 3 can help. Mac Scan 3 is a great defense against malicious software attacks aimed at your Mac. It's developed by Secure Mac, guys you've known for, well, at least a couple of years now through this show, but they're actually security professionals who have been hard at work protecting the Mac for well over a decade. MacScan 3 detects and removes Mac malware, catches keyloggers, removes tracking cookies, and provides full range or targeted scanning, all without crowding up your hard drive or slowing down your computer. Say goodbye to worry and hello to the comfort of security with MacScan 3 from Secure Mac. Sign up for a free 30-day trial today at securemac.com/MacScan. That's MacScan 3 by Secure Mac. Your 30-day free trial is waiting at securemac.com/MacScan. Let's finish the day with a quick follow-up story. In its massive mass of updates, Apple has apparently stuck a fork in GrayKey. It is done, at least for the time being. Forbes says iOS 12 seems to have stopped the iPhone passcode hack used by law enforcement and government agencies, and who knows who else? According to the report, Apple has put up what may be an insurmountable wall. Multiple sources familiar with the GrayKey tech tell Forbes the device can no longer break the passcodes of any iPhone running iOS 12 or above. On those devices, GrayKey can only do what's called a partial extraction, sources from the forensic community said. That means police using the tool can only draw out unencrypted files and some metadata, such as file sizes and folder structures. Now, I have a weird sense of fair. To me, that almost sounds like detective work, right? Being able to see the shapes and sizes of things without being able to get into the actual things. I mean, it's not nothing, but it feels like, it feels better to me for some reason. What about you?
Well, I always look at the real world analog of things. And, you know, just because you know the size and shape of a safe doesn't mean you know how much money's in it. And, I think this is exactly one of those things where, yeah, you can see the size of a folder, but you don't really know what's in it. Now, you can make some educated guesses. If you find a big file, it's probably video. Mm-hmm. But you don't know what that video is of, and there's nothing you can really do to actually view it. So, yes, I think it is better, not just for some reason, but because it does really kind of – and what GrayKey is supposed to be able to do.
Yeah. I don't mean to, and I mean, I know it's a horrible phrase to say it's not nothing, but I was using that intentionally. I mean, I am not somebody who says metadata is not data. I know metadata is a very real thing, and you can make a very real picture of something based on, without having that thing. If you can see all around a thing, you can pretty much see the thing, depending on, you know, what kind of information we're talking about. So it's not like I'm saying, well, it's just metadata, so who cares? But somehow this just feels like, well, it's like I said, it feels like detective work in a way.
Yeah, I think it's a little bit safer, or actually a lot safer for consumers and for those with devices than it was.
Previously, the piece continues, GrayKey used brute forcing techniques to guess passcodes and found a way to get around Apple's protections, preventing such repeat guesses, but no more. And if it's impossible for GrayKey, which counts an ex-Apple security engineer among its founders, it's a safe assumption few can break iPhone passcodes. Now, two things trouble me about that. One, with GrayKey broken, we might get complacent. And two, we don't know why GrayKey doesn't work anymore. Quoting Forbes, though it's clear Apple has locked GrayShift, that's the company that makes GrayKey, though it's clear that Apple has locked GrayShift out, no one actually knows just how the iPhone maker has done it. In fact, the piece says one of the higher-ups at Elcomsoft, a forensic tech firm, is kind of stumped by the whole thing too. No idea, he said. It could be everything from better kernel protection to stronger configuration profile installment restrictions. So, like, people who are supposed to know about this stuff don't actually know. Help me out, though, if you would, with my two concerns. I mean, is complacency even still possible at this point, or are we too awake to go back to sleep where hacks and cracks are concerned?
Well, I think, to be honest, the vast majority of the population is still complacent and still very much asleep. I think that we're becoming more awake The folks listening to this podcast are a great example of people who know what in the world's going on out there. And then they take that information and they share it, you know, with their parents or siblings or children or whatever, to make sure that those folks know as well. And it just sort of spreads from there. So I think it's too early to say that we're awake to all of this. Because mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of people who just don't even realize any of this stuff is going on, but I think we're getting better.
And then my other concern, do you wish that we knew how Apple had broken the hack, or are you just cool, you know, knowing that they have?
No, I'm very glad I don't know how Apple broke the hack. I kind of see this as sort of like the old Enigma machine, which was the Nazi encryption machine that they used in World War II. And the British were able to, you know, break that. And they knew everything that the Nazis were sending. And they actually let ships sink, knowing that people were going to die. Because if the Nazis had known that the Enigma machine was broken, they would have changed the encryption and people, and we wouldn't have known anything. And so this is, I think, very similar. Whereas if Apple told everyone how it was broken, then all of a sudden, you know, those ne'er-do-wells that you talk about would have a vector to try and go in and reverse what Apple was trying to do. So I think for them to keep their mouth shut is very, very smart, and let people puzzle on it for a while.
Well, it is tempting to say that this story is over. It's actually probably only over for now. Police officer Captain John Sherwin of the Rochester Police Department in Minnesota basically confirms the borking of GrayKey, though his feeling is, give it time and a workaround will be developed, and then the cycle will repeat. Someone's always building a better mousetrap, whether it's Apple or someone trying to defeat device security. Neither Apple nor Grayshift offered comment for the Forbes piece. That'd be kind of funny, though, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
And Grayshift's like, yeah, no, keep spending money with us, because otherwise we're going to have to start a Kickstarter to break the next one, I suppose.
And I'd like to point out something really quick about this story. You know, we talk about GrayKey and we talk about Grayshift, and not one Red Room joke in the whole story.
I don't know what you're talking about.
50 Shades of Grey.
Oh, wow. You are so suburban. That's all I'm going to say. Hey, if you're looking for more security news and how-tos or obscure, not obscure jokes, the place to look is securemac.com/checklist. Actually, don't go there for jokes, but go there for, you know, all kinds of stuff, like notes for this show, notes from the show before, notes from the show before that, and I think you start to get the idea. securemac.com/checklist. If you have a question you'd like to ask or a topic you'd like to hear us hit, our email address is checklist@securemac.com. That address again is checklist@securemac.com. And if you can't remember that, please do remember this. You're listening to The Checklist, brought to you by Secure Mac. And we'll talk to you next week.